picking some of my favorite chapters of the Bible and preaching through them, and the Lord's kind of using that to work in my life and in your lives. And so this morning we're in Colossians chapter 3. Back in 2013 is the last time I preached from Colossians here at the church, and at that time I preached through the entire book of Colossians. What was going on in Colossae is kind of similar to what happens sometimes in American churches. What was going on is that this kind of heresy called Gnosticism had crept into the church, and the Gnostics were denying the deity of Christ. They were denying the Trinity. They were denying that Christ was the only way to get to heaven. They were saying that you had to have a special knowledge in order to get to heaven. You had to know things other than what the Word of God taught you and what the apostles had taught you. And so this heresy slipped into the church, and this heresy is still in the church today in some denominations. And then during about 300 to 500 A.D., it was rampant in the church. And if you look at most of the church fathers, most of their writings was to kind of speak against Gnosticism. But today, that's when I preach this from the book of Colossians originally, that's kind of the slant that I use. But today I want to use a little different slant with this chapter. And I want to talk about perception, or perspective maybe is a better word than perception. I think perspective is a better word. You know, sometimes, I don't know if any of you have your own business. I have my own business. And sometimes in business, what can happen is that you get so busy with the task that you have to do each day that you lose perspective. And maybe in your jobs that happens to you sometimes. You know, the boss has an overriding goal that he wants you to accomplish as an employee, and you get so busy with the things that he gives you to do, the little things that you're given to do, that you lose perspective. Maybe sometimes in our marriages get so busy, and the kids are going this way and that way, and going to this ball game and that ball game, and going to school and this event, and choir practice and violin solo, and then and this and that and the other. Life gets so busy that even in family sometimes we lose our perspective. A lot of times, and what has really kind of hit me for all the time that I've been in the ministry, and even before I was in the ministry, is that a lot of times, a lot of Christians that I've come in contact through the years, and even myself at times, are not living the abundant life that Christ planned for us. And I find a lot of Christians that they're just not excited about the joy of their salvation anymore. They're not excited much about being saved. In fact, it just kind of becomes something like, you know, so what? You know, what have you got to offer me today? And so you can tell, now listen now, if you listen, say amen. You can tell that this has had an impact on our churches throughout the United States of America, because what people have begun to do, instead of talking about the higher things of God, what happens is preachers begin to bring things that are heavenly down to the earth to say, well, you know, here's the deal. You're saved, and yeah, you're going to have pie in the sky by and by, but in the meantime, you can have this, and you can have this, and you can have this, and God wants you to have this, and God wants you to have this. And all of those things are true to an extent. But what that has to happen is people are adding to the gospel message to keep Christians happy. Now, that is the wrong perspective. And somehow or another, what happens is, as Christians, we lose our perspective about who we are. That's what this chapter is all about. This chapter is Paul is reminding the Colossians who they are in Christ. How long has it been since you thought about who you are in Christ? That's why I love this passage of Scripture. The first four verses were one of 100 Bible verses that my oldest two sons and I memorized, that we used to say 25 each night before they would go to bed. And this one just kind of clung in my mind, and it stayed there for a long time. And it's been a while since I preached through this passage. So today what our goal is in our sermon today is to help all of us re-achieve the perspective of who we are as believers in Christ, so that when we go out into the world this week, instead of going out saying, hey, what happened, still like that guy up there saying, hey, what did your preacher preach about Jesus? And You know, instead of saying that, you can go out and you can think, my preacher preached off perspective, and what I'm meditating on this week is my relation to Christ and what that means to me now and what that's going to mean for me for all of eternity. Can I just tell you what the Lord Jesus has done in my life? Now, I tell you what. When you go out and you say that to an employee, to a neighbor or somebody like that, let me just tell you what Jesus is doing in my life, because you're excited about what Christ is doing in your life. You're excited about the promises and the hope in your heart. When you say those kind of things to somebody and invite them to church, they want to come because they see something exciting going on in your life, and they want something exciting going on in their life. So maybe the reason that sometimes people won't come to church with us is because they don't see anything exciting going on in our life and our relationship with Jesus Christ. So let's dig into it. We're going to kind of go verse at a time, word at a time, and look through it today. So you're going to need your Bibles up. So let's look at Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. Therefore, if you have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. So let's just talk about being raised up with Christ. What does that mean? In the world today, there's only two kind of people. You say, oh, Brother Don, there's a whole lot other kind of people than two kind of people. No, I'm not talking about male and female even. I'm talking about there are two kind of people. And the two kinds of people that are in the world today are those who are dead to God and alive to sin, and those who are dead to sin and alive to God. That's the only two kind of people in the world today. In the world today, there's those people that are dead to God and alive to sin, and those people that are dead to sin and alive to God. You say, well, nobody is dead to sin. Now, we all are dead to sin. We're all dead in sin if we're raised up with Christ. In other words, in our baptism, you can say our old man was buried and our new man was raised up with Christ. We are dead to our sins. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 through 12 says we've been separated from our sins. Circumcision was a picture of the separation of sin. We've been separated from our sin just as surely as when circumcision occurs, there's a separation of flesh. We've been separated from our sin and the penalty of our sin. We are dead to our sin now and alive to God thanks to Christ, because we've been raised up in Christ. Everybody in the world cannot say that. And so a lot of what this entire passage, these 17 verses we're going to look at today, is the fact that now we're dead to sin and alive to God. Let's all say that together. We're dead to sin and alive to God. Even though we still commit sin, even though that's still part of our lives, even though we resist it, even though we fight against it, we're dead to the penalty of it. We're dead to sin and alive to God. Then it says here, you who have been raised up with Christ, keep seeking those things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Now, what does it mean, seek those things above? The word above there is the word ano, A-N-O. Now, that means above. Over in John chapter 3, Jesus told Nicodemus, if you're going to see the kingdom of God, you've got to be what? Born again. Everybody remember that passage of Scripture? You've got to be born again. If you're going to enter into the kingdom of God, you must be born of water and the Spirit. So what does it mean to be born again? Words are interesting. Born again is the word anothen, from above, which means that when we get saved, we're born from above, which means now we're no longer born of the earth. We've been born again. We've been born from above. So therefore, since all of us in here are born from above, our citizenship is in heaven, from which we watch for the glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's Philippians chapter 3, verse 19 and 20. Since we've been born from above, we need to be seeking those things which are above. And right there is where we lose our perspective. We get so busy with the day in and day out living of this world. We get so busy and so hung up in our problems and our temptations and our trials. We get so busy with our families. We get so busy with our jobs that we quit seeking the things above and we're just trying to survive in the world. If you can identify with that, say amen. Amen. Did we do more last week? Did we do more seeking or were we more in survival mode? See, what's amazing to me, I really thought that by the time I got to 66 years of age, I thought life would be smooth out and simple. Yeah, you're waiting for it, brother. You only got about 6 months to go. But it's not. If anything, life, for me at least, is more complex today than it's ever been. If you can identify with that, say amen. There's a lot of reasons for that. One is our society, two is our technology, but our life now have become, and I guess really our family. And I had four kids, and I raised, you know, kind of two at a time, because I had four kids, two in this time era and two in that time era. And so it's kind of not like raising four at one time. But now I got four kids, I got three in-laws, I got, you know, married to my kids, I got seven grandkids. And so there's a whole world of complications that have come into our life, and that occurs. And so a lot of times we're just in survival mode. We just got to make it through the day. We just got to make it through the week. And we lose our perspective. And when we lose our perspective, we lose our joy in the Lord. When we seek those things that are above, which is where our citizenship is, which is where we were born, above, not of this world. When we seek those things which are above, at least once or twice or three times a day, it'll help us ground ourselves and help give us perspective of who we are. The next verse says, set your mind on things above. So Paul said this twice, not on things of this earth. The word mind is phronio. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16, it says that we have the mind of Christ. So we have the ability to think about godly things. We have been given the ability through our rebirth. See, when we were reborn, we got a new spirit, and we got a new soul, and our spirit and God's spirit was rejoined through the Holy Spirit. And when that occurred, all of a sudden now, as the body of Christ, now we have the mind of Christ. So in other words, we can set our mind on things above because we have the mind of Christ. Now, we don't always utilize the mind of Christ that each one of us have. Sometimes we utilize a mind that is old, a mind that was focused on things of the world more than the mind of Christ that wants to focus us on heavenly things. You see, the most important thing that we can do as a believer is to focus our mind on Christ. It was very interesting on the way down. Debbie said, what are you preaching? I said, Colossians chapter 3. She says, okay, smart aleck, what are you preaching? I said, we want to gain perspective about learning how to focus on things above. She says, that's what I'm teaching the kids today. I said, really? She said, well, not Colossians 3. I'm teaching the kids today how to abide in Christ. That's the same thing. To focus on things above and to abide in Christ is the same thing. Let's go on. Verse 3 is a very interesting verse. It says, for you have died. Everybody here that is dead, raise your hand. Remember, we're dead to our sin and alive to God. For you have died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Okay, this is really important. Now see, here's where a lot of Christians, after they've been saved for a while, if they don't get educated or taught properly, or if they don't get into the study of the Word of God, or if they don't go to church, or they don't have study buddies or something other, somebody discipling them, here's where a lot of Christians go astray. What they begin to look at, they begin to look at their salvation experience as a baptism, as a water experience, not a spiritual experience. The only reason we baptize in water, hey, listen, the only reason we baptize in water is because Jesus told us to. But that's after we make disciples. So the entire Christian life is a spiritual life right now. Because the rest of our life that Christ has given us is hidden. We can't see it. Where is it hidden? It's hidden in Christ. Where's Christ? He's in the third heaven, seated at the right hand of God. So what happens is because the only thing we can know about the Christian life right now is that we have a new soul. We want to do different things. We have a new spirit, and we're connected to God through the Holy Spirit, and that's really all we know about our new life. The rest of our new life is hidden with Jesus in heaven. But the good news is, verse 4, the good news is that when Christ, who is our life, Galatians chapter 2:20, it says, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but it's not me that lives, it's Christ that lives in me. Christ is my life. Let's all say that. Christ is my life. The life we live is not our life anymore, it's the life of Christ. When you got saved, you gave your life to who? To Jesus. And when Jesus birthed you again, what did he do? He claimed our life. And so now it's not our life, it's his life that we have been crucified. Now we have the life that we live is not our life, it's the life of Christ. But watch this. When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. So, the hidden life, our new glorified bodies, and everything that goes with that new life, the plans that Christ has for all of us, all of that will be revealed in due time. It'll be revealed at the resurrection of the just. That's called the first resurrection in the Bible. It's called the first resurrection. Everybody say first resurrection. That's what it's called. That will all of the things that are planned for us. And 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, John says, we have no idea what the wonderful plans are that Christ has planned for us, but when he appears, he'll let us know what they are. And that's exactly what we have to do. So in the meantime, we hold on and realizing that the life that he's got planned for us, we've only seen a little inkling of it, and we can only experience it right now in our spirit and our soul. And what we see all around us is not the life that Christ has planned for us. How can we possibly imagine what it's going to be like to have a glorified body that doesn't even think about sin? How can we imagine what it's going to be like to have a glorified body that doesn't even get sick? How can we imagine to have a glorified body that's going to live forever? Even imagine that? How can we live? Even imagine living in a glorified body that's never going to get fat? How can we imagine any of that kind of things? We can't. It's hidden in Christ. But when Christ comes, all of it will be revealed. It says that we're in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that now we see through a glass darkly. Or now we see what's planned for us through a dark glass. In other words, it's kind of like we're looking in a mirror. Oh, this is good stuff. Listen, think about this. It's kind of like we're looking in a mirror to see what our eternal life's going to be, and all we can see right now is us and our problems. And we can see that we're saved. Yahoo! We're saved, but we can't see anything else because everything else is on the other side of the mirror. We see our eternal life through a dark glass. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We live in hope, realizing that when Christ comes, all those things that we want to know about, all those things that we've hoped for will be revealed unto us. Well, let's go on. Verse 5 begins kind of a new thing. All right, so therefore, since we are saved, since we are in Christ, since our life is a new life that is hidden with Christ and will be revealed to us, how should we live? All right, it comes down here to verse 5. Therefore, consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. So in other words, what Paul is saying, he says, listen, even though you can't see everything that's going to occur, even though you don't know exactly what your eternal life is going to be like, you are alive in Christ and dead to sin. Therefore, since you're dead, kill the lust of the flesh is basically what it means. That's what it is in over Romans chapter 8, verse 12 and 13. It says, mortify the deeds of the flesh. The deeds of the flesh war against the will of the Spirit. That's what it says over in Galatians chapter 5. And so what Paul is saying is now that you realize who you are, kill the flesh. But you see, I would say to you, I would contend that what we do is that we feed the flesh more than we feed the spirit. And I'm not talking about food. I'm saying we feed the flesh much more than we feed the spirit. We think about earthly things much more than we think about spiritual things. Amen? We think about things down here much more than we think about things up there. You know, if I spent a third of the time thinking about Jesus as I did thinking about my business, I'd be a whole lot closer to Jesus. If I spent a third of the time I spend worrying about my children and worrying about my relationship with Christ instead, I'd be a whole lot closer to Jesus. If I spent a third of the time thinking about Jesus that I do thinking about building a house on the lake, I'd be a whole lot closer to Jesus. But you see, we get so wrapped up that instead of killing the flesh, we feed the flesh and we kill the spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 says, walk in the spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh, because the flesh lusts against the spirit. The only way that we know what our eternal life is, the only way we know anything about Christ is through the spirit. And the only way to be close to Christ is through the Spirit. But the flesh wars against the Spirit. Paul, over in Romans chapter 7, verse 15 through 22, I think. And I'm so glad that Paul put this in there, because otherwise I would think that I'm constantly a failure as a believer. But Paul had a continual struggle between what was going on inside of his new soul and his spiritually connected spirit. He had such a huge struggle between that and his body and the lust of the flesh. All kinds of things. Anger, wrath, jealousy, greed, all the things that are named here. It says, therefore consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, greed, which amounts to idolatry. And see, Paul struggled with those things, just like we do. In fact, he even cried out in Romans chapter 7, O body of this death, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? But then he said, but I see another law. He said, I see the law of sin working in my members, but he says, I see the law of the Spirit working in my soul. And then he concludes, now therefore there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. So we're no longer condemned by our sin, but we still struggle with it. If you still struggle with sin, say amen. And we're going to struggle with it until we get that new life, which is currently hidden in Christ. But Paul says, you got to win this battle. He said, win this battle. And then he goes on, he says something really interesting. Verse 6, he says, for it is because of these things that the wrath of God will come upon the sons of disobedience. I'm really not a fire and brimstone preacher. I don't hardly ever preach about, if you're a sinner and you don't accept Christ, you're going to end up in the lake of fire. I don't preach that very often. But I think I really need to say something about this today. I pray that everybody in this room is saved and everybody in this room born again, bound for glory to that life that's hidden with Christ. I pray that it's true. But you may have a relative, you may have a friend who is not. And here's the deal. And even as believers, here's the deal. We cannot escape from God. That thought, I was driving down the boulevard on the way to work, and that thought just blasted me. We cannot escape from God. In other words, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, say amen. All right? We cannot escape from God. He's going to judge us and make us accountable for how we're living our lives as believers. If you're not a believer in Christ, you cannot escape from God. No matter what happens to you, you can't escape. If you die, He's there. If you live, He's there. You cannot escape from God. Now consider that. Even if we don't want, now listen now, even someone that does not want to be accountable to God will be. Over in Philippians chapter 2, it says, every knee shall bow. Those above heaven, those in heaven, those under the earth, every knee shall bow and proclaim Jesus Christ is Lord. You cannot escape God. Whether you're a believer or not a believer, we're all accountable to God. And those who are sons of disobedience, which means they're dead to God and alive to sin, they're going to experience the wrath of God. That we who are alive to God and dead to sin, we won't experience God's wrath, but we will experience God's chastisement if we don't live properly as believers. In 1 Corinthians 11, it says, no foundation can any man lay for his salvation other than Jesus Christ. But let every man be careful how he builds on his foundation of salvation, wood, hay, stubble, gold, silver, precious stones. And it says, every man's work shall be made manifest, the day shall declare it. And anything that is burned up in the fire of that judgment day, he'll suffer a loss, and everything that abides that fire, he'll be given a reward. So since most of us in here are believers in Christ, what we have to consider is, what are we laying on our foundation of salvation? Are we laying up wood, hay, and stubble? Or are we laying up gold, silver, precious stones? You know what? Someday the only thing that's going to be important is that. Two things are going to be important to us when we die. Believers in Christ, and what did we do as believers in Christ? And everything else is going to be unimportant. But those two things are going to be super important. In fact, the most important. In fact, eternally important. Do we know Christ? If we do know Christ, what did we do after we knew Him and became one with Him? Let's go on. You go on now down to verse 8. But now you also put them all aside, anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech from your mouth. I don't have to go over all those. You know whether you're ever guilty of those. If they are, then we need to not do that. We need to ask forgiveness from God for those things and ask forgiveness for whoever becomes a participant in those things. Do not lie to one another, since you laid aside the old self with its evil practices. And now we're coming down to verse 10. In verse 10, every passage of Scripture usually has a verse on which the entire passage turns. And for us, it's verse 10. And you have put on the new self, who is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created them. A whole lot of stuff there. It says that we're being renewed. I want to read you. That's the Greek word anakeno. And I know that some of you say, well, that's all Greek to me. I don't read the Greek. But sometimes it's good to read the Greek. So I printed out this definition of renewed, anakeno, from the Greek. And here's the definition. In this verse, it's used in the passive, to be renewed completely by God. It refers to the redemptive activity of God corresponding to the creation of man, which by putting an end to man's existing corrupt state establishes a new beginning. Who wants a new beginning? Amen? Guess what? We all got it already. When we accepted Christ, we got a new beginning, qualitatively different than the past, in agreement with the meaning of the word kainos, renewed. So we are all who are in Christ, we're renewed. We're born again. That's the same idea. We're born again, renewed. And because of that, we know we're a new self. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says that we are new creatures in Christ. And it's interesting, if you go look at that passage, Scripture, it says we're new creatures in Christ. Who's ever heard that before? We're new creatures in Christ. But that word creature there, new creatures in Christ, that's the word anakeno, the same word, renewed. We're new creatures in Christ. We're not the same anymore. Maybe we look the same. Maybe sometimes we act the same when the flesh gets the best of it, but we're not the same anymore. When we got saved, we got changed. Amen? The best way, somebody says, Brother Don, how do I know whether or not I'm saved? Did you change? Did you change? When we truly got saved, we changed. Maybe every once in a while, the old man will kind of rear its ugly head. But then, you feel guilty. In the past, the old man, when the old man would rear his ugly head and do something stupid, you didn't feel guilty. But now, when you do something wrong, can't hardly stand it. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, it's like you're having a heart attack. It's like you're having, it's like pressure on your chest. It's like you got to get rid of it because you can't stand it to be in your life because you know you messed up. Because we've been changed. And we can't stand that life anymore. We can't stand thinking those thoughts anymore. We can't stand acting like that anymore because we've been changed. We are new creatures in Christ. And because of that, now we have the true knowledge of Christ. Now, I want you to think about this. Jesus said something very interesting to the scribes and Pharisees over in John chapter 8. In John chapter 8, he's talking to guys that have spent their entire lives studying the Bible. In fact, most of them knew the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, by memory. They knew backward and forward. told them that they didn't know the truth. They could read all of those things, and they never saw the truth. It's really hilarious sometimes when they have these specials on the History Channel or whatever, and they'll consult a preacher of religious studies at Harvard or Yale or wherever about a comment about this or that or the other from the Bible, and you listen to the guy and you say, he doesn't have a clue what he's talking about. Or how about this? Or somebody at work says, well, what does it really mean to be a believer in Christ? Or how do you square this about Christ? Or this, that, and the other. And you tell them the truth. And they just look at you with blank faces. Here's the deal. Nobody outside of new believers, new creatures in Christ, can understand the Word of God. The only thing they can understand, really, is that they're a sinner and they need Jesus. They can understand that. But the rest of the knowledge of the Bible, they cannot understand. But you can take the most uneducated person in the world who is saved and who is being led by the Spirit, and they can take their Bibles and just turn it inside out with knowledge. My grandmother, I don't know, probably 6th, 7th, 8th, maybe 8th grade of education. I doubt it because, she was born in the 1800s, so maybe not, maybe 8th grade, maybe. Lived in coal country in Kentucky, maybe. But man, does she know the Bible. Better than me, I think, probably. It'd be really fun now to sit down and talk to her for about 100 hours. That'd be really cool. And not going to get that chance now, but later on with that life hidden in Christ, yeah, then we will. But she knew the Bible back and forth. My grandfather, a little less education, but he knew the Bible as well, but just not like my grandmother, because I think she had a gift. And it's going to blow you away. This has nothing to do with what I'm talking about, but I want you to think about it. I was thinking about this the other day. I think a lot when I drive about heavenly things, because I drive really fast, and I try to keep my thoughts on heavenly thoughts just in case at some moment in time that airbag comes out, and splats me. But anyhow, my grandmother, I spent a lot of time with my grandmother because after my grandfather died, she was afraid to sleep in her house at nights. And so since I only lived two houses away, I was volunteered by my father to be the one at least three or four times a week to go down and stay with her so she wouldn't be scared. So now she's got like a 9-year-old kid, guarding her in the house, And she felt bad because she didn't have any TV. She didn't believe in, she was Pentecostal, had real long hair and long sleeves and this and that and the other. She didn't believe in TV. But she felt bad that she knew I liked to watch TV, so she had the boys, that's what she called them, my father and my uncle, get her a TV. And she was able to get one channel, and that was the Oral Roberts channel. But I think my grandmother, now this is going to sound so conceited, but my grandmother had tremendous impact on a lot of people, including a lot of pastors that pastored the church that her and my grandfather started, actually. And I think that she was gifted for that reason, but she was also gifted to make an impact on me. I didn't learn, I've told you this story, but it's such a powerful story. When I pastored my last church, one of the former wives of one of the former pastors that my grandmother had a women's conference. And in that conference, she revealed to the women there the power of prayer, and that how Miss Presley, my grandmother, had caused them to, she said she was praying every day and had the women in the church praying every day that I would become a minister, a preacher. Now, I'm pretty sure she wanted me to be a Pentecostal preacher, okay? But to Baptist, I guess, was good enough, maybe. But I didn't know that until I'm already a pastor of a church. And my people come in on that Sunday morning and tell me that story. So, you never know if you're gifted. If you have the ability, all of us in this room, if you're in this room, say amen. You have the ability, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you have the ability to understand the true knowledge. Don't ever say, I don't read my Bible because I can't understand. because that's just not true. You can. Usually, you don't understand your Bible because you're just, can we just talk? You're just not reading it. That's the truth. And I usually very graciously tell people that when they tell me that they can't understand the Bible. I say, sure you can, because you can. But maybe not like me, maybe not like other people that you know, maybe not like even your grandmother or whatever, but you can understand the Scripture without any education other than just reading the Scripture. Good to get a good study Bible. We've talked about that. Good to get some helps. Good, that's a good thing. But you can understand those Scriptures. Because now that you're born again, now that you have that new life, you can understand the true knowledge. You really can. Let's go on. And so verse 11 says, you've received a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free man, but Christ is all and in all. No matter who you are, no matter what country you're from, no matter whether you're male or female, Greek or Jew, whatever, whether you can understand the Word of God, we're all one in Christ. And we've all been ordained to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. And that is occurring in each one of us right now. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse about 17 or 18. All of us right now, through the Holy Spirit, are being conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. Every single one of us in this room, not only do we have a new life, but that new life is formed to the image of Jesus. Let's go on. Now we're in verse 12. So as those who have been chosen of God, we are the elect of God. We've been chosen by God. Everybody say that. I've been chosen by God. We've been chosen to be holy. That word is hagios. That means we've been set aside for God. That means every one of us in this room, if you've ever been in a church, and like a Catholic church perhaps, and they have an area that's reserved only for the holiest stuff, all their utensils and that, and they've got the little holy of holy things which they pull the communion out of. I tell you what, none of that is as holy as each one of us. God has declared us to be holy. We are set aside for Him. That's what holiness means. We don't act holy necessarily, but we are holy to God, which means we are special to God. We've been chosen by God. We are special to God, and we are beloved by God. Therefore, since we have been chosen, since we are holy, and since we are loved by God, put on a heart of compassion, put on kindness, put on humility, put on gentleness, put on patience, bear with one another, forgive each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord also forgave you. Biggest single problem in the church, right there. Forgiveness. I struggle with it. You struggle with it. We all struggle with it. If you struggle with forgiveness, say amen. We do. We all struggle with that. So, I'm not going to preach on that anymore because that's really not the sermon for the day. But it is. Because here's the deal. When you have an unforgiving attitude towards somebody, when somebody's really hurt you and you're really upset with them and you have an unforgiving attitude towards that individual, 90% of the time it's a family member. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands on that one. But 90% of the time, the only people that affect us enough that we stay mad or unforgiving for a long period of time are usually family members. Or good friends. The other 10% are good friends. But when we have an unforgiving spirit working in our lives, we've surrendered to the flesh. And once we surrender to the flesh, it's impossible for us to live in the spirit. We're still saved, but we're walking in the flesh. And remember, the flesh is contrary to the spirit. We can't keep our perspective about who we are. We can't stay close to Jesus while we're walking in the flesh. And so as long as there is unforgiveness in our heart, it takes away our joy. I've said it 1,000 times. We have to forgive even when it hurts. And we have to let it go. I don't know how you do it. Pray for the individual. Whatever you want to do, just let it go. Don't do it for their benefit. as much as for your benefit. Then we go on, verse 14. Beyond all these things, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. And this word love here is agape. If you read sometime or another over in 2 Peter chapter 1, it says all of us were and then we began to grow. First we just kind of grew in faith. And then we began to grow in knowledge because people began to teach us. Then we grew in the desire to do good. And from the desire to do good, we grew into kind of like brotherly love like thing where we just loved everybody. And then as we matured, ultimately we grew into agape love, which is unconditional love, which very few of us have gotten to that point. That's unconditional love. That's when you love the unlovable. That's when you love people that hate you. That's when you do good to those that despitefully use you. But that is the ultimate in the Christian maturation is agape love. That's when you do, when you love and you do those things that are needful for people regardless how they have treated you. Verse 15, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts to which indeed you were called in one body and be thankful. I've talked about it before. There's such a thing called the grace package. Everybody say that, grace package. And in that package is the peace of God. And if you want peace in your life, then you have to let the peace of God that is already in you rule in your hearts. The peace of God is already in your life. It is part of your grace package that you receive from Jesus. We can let that grace package rule in our lives. We can let the peace of God rule in our hearts, and we will have peace. Another part of the grace package, it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. With all wisdom, teaching, admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your heart. And every single time I think of that passage of Scripture, I think about, once again, my grandmother, who was constantly either singing a hymn or constantly singing a psalm with some sort of melody. I'm telling you, she understood what it meant to sing a hymn and a spiritual song and singing with thankfulness and making melody in your heart. She understood that. So we have to let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. And then verse 17, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. You're walking down the street. Guy comes up and says, hey, I haven't had anything to eat for 2 days. I need to have some lunch. You give him $5. When you do that, say, I do this for you in the name of Jesus. Jesus loves you. Always do that. Just that simple. Jesus loves you. Regardless what he's going to do with it, you know, and regardless how he's going to use it, he will know at that moment in time that he's being given that $5 in the name of Jesus. Always do that. And that way Jesus gets the glory and not us. Amen. Always in the name of Jesus. So today I hope that this sermon is a motivation to all of us that this week we need to gain proper perspective of who we are in Christ and how Christ wants us to live. It's a very difficult thing. Anything we do in this life, once we've established certain patterns and certain habits, are difficult to break, are difficult to change. So this week, spend some extra time reading in the Word, spend some extra time praying, spend some extra time listening to the Christian music, spend some extra time thinking, just meditating on what it means to be born again. Just spend some time meditating on what it means to be born from above. Just spend some extra time thinking that your citizenship is in heaven, from which we watch for the glorious appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Memorize some Scripture this week. These are all things that you can do. It's not things that you have to do. We don't live by law. We live by grace. But Jesus wants us to be close to him. So do whatever it takes to get close to Jesus. Do whatever it takes to get close to Jesus. There was an old man and woman driving down the road. And he was driving. And she's sitting in the passenger seat. And they pulled up next to a 57 Chevrolet. That had lifters on it, and the guy was revving his engine, and his girlfriend was almost sitting in his lap. And the woman looked at the man, and she says, I remember when I used to sit almost in your lap when we drove around, and he looked at her and said, I'm not the one that moved. You'll get that when you get home. If you don't feel close to Jesus, he's not the one that moved. You can be as close to Jesus, we can be as close to Jesus as we want to be. Father, I thank you for the day. I thank you, Lord, that you've given us access to you, unlimited access to you. I pray, Lord, that you would forgive us for those times that we don't take advantage of that. I pray, Lord, that you forgive us those times that we lose our perspective. Lord, I believe that everybody in this room wants to be close to you. I believe everybody wants to have a closer walk with you. And so, Lord, I would just pray for us all this week, Lord. Help us. Help our weakness. Help our infirmity. Help our struggles. Help our trials. Help our temptations, Lord. Help us this week, Lord, to draw closer to you. This is our prayer this morning, Lord. And we also pray this morning, Lord, that if there's anybody here this morning, Lord, that is not a believer in Jesus Christ, has not been born again, I pray that your Holy Spirit right now would begin to convict them of their sins and their need to be saved today. Lord Jesus, we love you and we praise your holy name. And everybody said, amen. Let's all